everybody doing today? It's a gray Thursday, middle of May. It's the kind of weather that makes me want to hear April in Paris, especially by Count Basie or Billie Holiday, perhaps. I'm going to delve into a few things today. I want to talk about Gil Mel. He's an interesting player, an important figure in Blue Note. Early especially, but he's also a bit of an enigma and illustrates some of the differences between the white and the black musicians. We'll get into that a little bit later, but me and my friend Steve Clark, who at least from the United Kingdom if I recall, we've been having interesting dialogue. He's a knowledgeable guy. He knows his stuff, and we were discussing recently the links between jazz and classical, and there's certainly bridges where the sounds cross. And a guy like Gil Mel at times feels very composed and arranged, and there's a certain lack of the blues and a certain lack of sexuality in some of his music. Doesn't mean it's not interesting soundscapes, because a lot of it is just that. It's interesting soundscapes with elements of jazz, but it also borrows from the European tradition. And that's the interesting dichotomy I want to discuss for a second, is the experience of the blues, and for the most part, swing and jazz. It's a very sexually driven, enticing, pulsing, fiery sound. I'm going to drive that home with this real quick. The tempo. It's not about intricate, interwoven fabric of sound as much as it is. Let's go. Let's tap our feet. Let's dig it. Let's feel it. Versus, which definitely has a more of a European feel, a cafe in Vienna, a streetscape in Turin, a lovely afternoon in Antwerp. The European tradition is there around the edges of jazz, but blues and jazz do not intersect. Blues and classical do not intersect. Big difference. Classical does not have that same pulsing sexuality, looseness. There's a more of a rigidity and a stoic presence to what's written, and that's very sacrosanct. Here, it's so converse that it's like what's written has zero meaning. There is no rating. We're going to loosely use those four chords, and let's go. And the chords, the head, almost becomes just the map that we're playing on in an open world game. We can go anywhere. That's just north, south, east, and west, those four chords. So we know we have directions that we're in, but I can really express freely. This feels far more chamber. It's very neat. It's very clean. This is very early Blue Note. This is 10 inch number 5020. Puts it probably 51, 52. He does four 10 inches for Blue Note in 51 to 55. This is the only one I have, sadly. Another one with Tal Farlow. There's another one on Herbie Green. There's another one with Lou Mecca. Another one called Patterns and Color. I'll probably put up pictures of those so you can see them. I don't have them yet. Gil Mel's an interesting guy. And I like a lot of his compositions and arrangements. And we're going to dig into his career to see what he does. But like, that's as swinging as he gets. And this could be almost Henry Mancini, Neil Hefti, And of course, he does cross over into television and film. And that's all he's doing by the 70s and the mid-60s. But that could be a scene in Star Trek. Captain Kirk is stopped in a meadow on a distant land to talk to a beautiful maiden. And Jim and Spock are about to beam down and interrupt this man's romance. Damn those guys. Beam us up, Scotty. He just broke up my moment. Captain Kirk ain't happy. Gilmel can do that. That's what Gilmel does. And Alfred and Frank, I'm sure they knew, they heard him. They were impressed by his production and his sound. It was actually Gilmel who brings Rudy Van Gelder to Alfred Lion. Some of Gilmel's first recordings Van Gelder produced. Alfred and Frank were impressed by the sound, and they introduced each other, and Van Gelder goes on to engineer and produce all the Blue Note stuff from 53 to 67. The only exceptions being a few things that were recorded in Europe that they licensed and issued here. Like, that's go-to. What's crazy about Van Gelder is a guy we're going to do an episode on eventually. Is simultaneously, he's recording for Savoy, or engineering for Savoy. He's doing stuff for Prestige. He does a little bit for Riverside. He's gets into the 60s. He's doing stuff for Verve. Like, he's just kind of omnipresent and a huge part of the jazz sound. And I do think part of Van Gelder's place in jazz is elevated in part because he was always willing to work with black musicians, which not everybody was, so that puts him in a place where he ends up recording a lot of black musicians. Almost by default, he becomes the go-to guy as much for his availability and willingness to work with this lower-class citizens, as it were, and not have to worry about being bumped by a white group that came in or a white pop singer. Van Gelder booked you. This day was meant for Blue Note. This day was meant for Prestige. And there was no consideration of race in Van Gelder's booking. And so, did you want to take the risk of taking a big band, or even a four or five piece band, to a Manhattan studio and have someone at the front desk not let you in, and then some guy come down from the third floor and say, we can't record you guys for some bullshit reason, which in the black experience, that's still commonplace today. As a DJ, I can tell you that. I guarantee you that. Blacks get their shit bumped for white folks. It's just how it is. And if you think it wasn't that way in 1954, you haven't paid much attention to the black experience. And it's hard to grasp the black experience in America. When you're white, all you hear about is black on black crime, the threat and the fear of the black inner city. If you live in rural America, your news broadcasts have you terrified to step onto the city streets of even mid-sized American cities. And when you don't have understanding or comprehension, you cannot have empathy, and therefore, in the misunderstandings where fear and hate thrives. And that's the key to the discord in this country to this day. They keep us so divided and so polarized that we will never achieve unity and thus have the power in a democracy to change the course of things. Democracy requires unison at some point. It requires us working together across party lines, across certain divides. And so much of the economic political divide has been shaded with social divides that are often very artificial but magnified in the media, so that we spend all our time voting on these social issues and the economic issues slip right under the radar. Wolves in sheep's clothing. You know, the big economics of industry and finance are the governing body, not politicians. Politicians are temporal beings that work in a government job for a short term who don't grasp most of the machine that they're a part of. And that's from local level all the way up to the federal level. A lot of federal Congress people are pretty normal average day Joes that get into a situation that's so much grander than they could ever conceive, let alone having a grasp of foreign policy and military campaigns. They have no information or conspiracy or design to control the world. Congress is just that. How can I represent my constituents and possibly line my pockets as much as I can while I'm here? Because that's what everybody else is doing. But they don't got no unity. They don't got no grand scheme. The elite, the financial financiers of the world create politics that's so divided and powerless, and we just sit here butting heads with each other instead of ever drinking clean water. But me and Steve Clark have been talking, and where does classical and jazz meet? And I think one of the most impressive things about jazz music, and to me, again, this is like a Star Trek episode. Picard or Kirk lands on some distant planet where we once left a harp by mistake. We didn't mean to leave that instrument there, and we came back two generations later, and these cats had invented a whole new way to play that instrument. It doesn't sound any way we imagined it sounding. They play in a way that we never imagined it being played. It's making a whole new form of music that is a sound that we've never envisioned or even imagined. When the black youth in America first had access to white man's instruments, and remember, this is a time where these instruments were all the instruments there was. There wasn't 808s and drum machines and programs and samplers. You know what I mean? There was no technology. You had actual physical instruments at your disposal. And when the white schools got done with their beat up woodwinds and horns, they passed them off and donated them to the black schools. You got black kids taking up their captors' beat up trumpets and clarinets and instruments. And out of that came a whole new sound, where many of these instruments were reinvented so completely, tonally, rhythmically, the sound of jazz and its sexuality, and then the application of the blues. Once you grow, once you throw the blues in there, and the blues came up on washboards, the blues came up on broken guitars with four strings on it. The blues wasn't a complex instrument or a vehicle for complex arrangement. The blues didn't house large suites and movements and chambered pieces. The blues was, I got four strings, a washboard, and he's got a harmonica. Let's tap out some shit. I feel like shit. And it just goes off on how it feels. The emoting of jazz makes it very different than the written context of classical music. Classical music, when you play that piece, you play it like it was written. And it doesn't matter where that music is being played. It can be played in St. Petersburg. It can be played in Rio de Janeiro. It can be played in Canberra. It can be played in Ottawa. That chamber music, that orchestra, that symphony is going to play it like it was written, with little embellishment, little addition of my personality to the part I'm playing. It's like the first trumpet or the first clarinet gets up in a symphony and decides to inflect a bunch of his guttural emoting feelings on top of a Mozart, Beethoven, or Bach piece. You play what's written. Jazz is so contrary to that. This is just how we feel. We're going to use your instruments because that's all that's available to us, and express something different. And there was no formal music education for young black youths, and especially in the time of Louis Armstrong, Sidney Bechet, King Oliver. You know, these guys just made it work. And the links to classical do come across with Gil Evans and Oliver Nelson and Gil Melle and John Lewis. Guys like that. Lee Konitz had a real knowledge of it. Those guys do grasp sometimes the arranged theory side of things. And truthfully, when you played with Mingus, you were going to have to play somewhat like the arrangement, because even Mingus borrows a lot from the composed European tradition. Ellington, however, as composed as his music was, and as arranged as it was so rooted in the blues, it was so rooted in improvisation, that even his sacred chamber music always had the blues in it. It always had the gospel in it. And I don't think Ellington was going to shoot a glance at his bandmates for sharing how they felt today and going off script some in an inspired manner. Jazz functions and lives and exists in inspired moments of improvisation, conversely, Starship Enterprise now was just taken off. And we're going into warp drive because we have to get to a far distant galaxy so that we can get a time drive to remove the heart from this people to take this music away from them. Like, Gil Mel's in. And like Mancini, he has jazz in his repertoire. He knows how to play a swing beat with a rhythm section and instruct that. But his baritone is sax playing, and he goes into synthesizers deeply on his electronic music when he which is coming up. But and so I like people to share with me your thoughts. How rooted in classical is jazz in your guys' minds? Steve Clark made some great points, and I do think there are bridges. I do think there are times where you listen to Mingus, Black Saint, and the Sinner Lady, and the European tradition is fairly evident. Sketches of Spain is obviously rooted in Spain and Iberia as much as it could be. You know, when you're listening to Sketches of Spain, Ibiza, Minorca, and Mallorca are right across the Iberian Strait. You want to go. You know, it really is a visual art form. And that's, to me, one of the things about classical versus jazz, is classical is a visual art form. It's painting pictures and telling a narrative through that imagery, but it's very static, and jazz is always expressing feelings. And how I feel today might be a lot different than how I felt yesterday. And classical can't do that. Classical, with all of its incredible intricacy and complexity, 1812 Overture is going to sound today like it does tomorrow. But if I'm Johnny Griffin and Eddie Lockjaw Davis, there's a soft rain falling today, boys. I'm going to swing soft to get my groove in my field. Ooh, honey, look at that butt. See what I'm saying, sugar? She good looking. This is a much looser, simpler tale of a couple brothers talking about some sugar. And if you don't think Lockjaw and Griff are talking about that sugar, that's 5-6 feet of fury right there. Lockjaw's the man. And again, it doesn't want to glorify the struggle as much as help maintaining it through the struggle. It's an interesting topic. I'm going to jump back into Gil Mel here because I do love his music. It does fill an interesting place in jazz history. It's one of the great things about jazz is how it can graft into itself harps, accordions, harmonicas. You can really dive into a lot of different sounds in jazz very successfully, as long as that feeling is what is driving the music. Again, I don't have his other 3 10-inches on Blue Note. They're not cheap, of course. And I'll probably buy a reissue when I get the chance. I don't really want the Japanese twofer, especially since it has that one on it. This is his first Blue Note on 12-inch, number 1517. Egg Thigpen, Oscar Pettiford, the great Joe Cinderella's on guitar, who's a guy you don't hear much from. I don't think he has any albums as a leader in this era, if ever. Eddie Burt's on this as well, the great trombone player. There's, of course, Thigpen and Pettiford, and there's Gil Mel on the saxophone. This, I believe, is a Music Matters. But again, I'm so not a reissue. I don't really look at what pressing I'm by when I buy a record. I want the music, I want the art, I want the information. I want to know what chapter of jazz that was a part of, not who's pressing it today. I don't really give a fuck. I don't. I want the music. And if I gotta buy a 70s copy, a 50s copy, I also want an original if I can get it, but some records are just so expensive that I'm just gonna buy what I can find. In the case of this one, the only thing I could find to buy this 10 years ago was this pressing. And I probably paid $40 for it, $50 for it. And I've listened to it many times. I don't really care for the double record 45 RPM format. It's kind of annoying not to get up and change a record that often. Certainly do. They do a nice job. It's beautiful. The music's what matters. And again, it's not anything more than what does it make me feel. And the pressing shouldn't change that. The pressing shouldn't inform that in any way. If you can't feel a story, it's a bit like if you're reading Tom Sawyer. Does the fact that you're reading in paperback prevent you from understanding the story? Or is it the same story in a paperback as it would be in an original first edition or a leather-bound edition? You see what I'm saying? The story's the story. That's what's important. Gil Mel, of course, then moves on to Prestige. And he makes three more records at Prestige to go with his four records at Blue Note, all in the late 50s. This is Primitive Modern, 70-40, probably early 57, late 56. I don't see the band. Oh, there's Joe Cinderella again. Billy Phillips and Eddie Thigpen's on the drums again. So this is actually just a quartet, looks like. I actually think his Prestige stuff is fairly swinging. There's an element of blues even in that. But still, it's very soft. And it's almost chamber jazz. It's almost like you're in, again, Star Trek, and the replicator is giving you a coined version of what jazz is. This would be just fine for that. You know what I mean? But I actually love these records, I really do. It just doesn't have the blues of a black man. And a white guy, he can definitely have his struggle. He can definitely have his pain and his sorrow. And there's no question that they can emote and say things through jazz. I don't want to ever diminish white jazz players. White jazz players can play and are fantastic emoters. It's just, it's important to recognize a guy in jazz can only express from his experience. It's not like a rapper that can start telling you streets of the tales of the street and he never been there. A guy emoting through his soul into his horn can only reflect on what he knows about. And so whether it's Gil Mel, whether it's Shelly Manne and the West Coast Cats, or whether it's Hank Mobley Lee Morgan, they can only inform you about what they're informed about. They can only express on what they feel. And that's why jazz is so wonderful. It's so honest. And honesty is the most important thing in this world to me. I want to know truth. I want to seek, understand it. I want to feel. I want to connect with what I love. And if I can't feel a genuine thing coming from my art, my life, whatever, I can't connect with it. I need to believe in it, because I don't believe in much else. I've been forsaken in this life by most of the things I thought were doctrine. History is twisted by the elite. The media is full of bullshit. Government is manipulated by the elite. Religion. We all know who's pulling the strings there. Where can I find honesty? Art is the one place where you can hope an artist is going to tell you how he really feels. And whether it's the book of Revelations and John speaking about how he wants the kingdom of the empire of Rome to fall and there to be a great judgment coming and this coded message of a great day of reckoning. And again, that's a message that will always ring out through time. This is a bigger group here. It's got Watkins, Louis Watkins, Vinnie Burke's on bass, who I love, Joe Cinderella, Ed Thigpen, Hal McCusick's on some of the numbers. Art Farmer, Gil Mel. It looks like it might be two sessions here. Don Butterfield's on tuba. And looks like Dorham and Farmer switch places on a couple of the tracks. Probably 1956, 57. I wish they would put dates on more clearly for people to always be able to read. It's 70-63 in prestige. That puts it in 57-58. But that doesn't always mean it was recorded then. And being that it's got two different lineups, that would tend to make me think that potentially this was actually recorded earlier. But this is the last record he does on Prestige, and kind of wraps up his jazz era for the most part. This is 70-97, probably 59. This is a beautiful promo copy of this record. One of my old beautiful Prestige records I got. And I think there's actually a little bit more blues to these Prestige records than there is to his Blue Note, especially the 10-inch stuff. Shadow Wilson shows up on the drums here. Gil Mel, Joe Cinderella, and George Duvivier is on the bass. So you got two white dudes and two brothers. And having a couple brothers laying down the rhythm is never going to hurt in the blues department. You know, that's never going to be a detraction. That's for certain. But, I do want to mention some of his later achievements. This is Gil Mel Tome 6. It's on Verve, 8744. I believe it is an electronic experiment. And he delves into synthesizers hardcore. And does some pretty interesting stuff. Little George Harrison electronic sounds, a lot of the Brian Eno stuff from the 70s. This is kind of a precursor to some of that stuff. There's jazz elements there, very free. And then it goes back to Star Trek. So very much we're seeing his movement towards Hollywood and being a film producer. And in the vein of classical music, that has been the score for most of our films throughout the history of film, is classical kind of arranged pieces that create tension, create escape, you know what I mean? Creating even the feel of tension, danger, romance, love. But again, it's a static feel because it's always going to present that itself that way. That's never going to all of a sudden feel like we're going to have a good time down at the Chicken Shack right there. That's always going to feel like if one more valve breaks, the submarine's going to sink. And that's kind of the nature of this music. Again, the fact that they borrowed so much from the European instruments in jazz, certainly too, I think, myself as a young listener of jazz, I had a hard time defining what was swinging hard and what wasn't really swinging. In part because some of my introductions to jazz are so on the borders, like Sketches of Spain. It was probably in the first 40 jazz records I owned. Bitches Brew was in the first 40 records I owned. Those records inform me incorrectly what jazz is. The Gil Evans, Miles Davis stuff, that stuff on the borders. And it certainly doesn't define the blues and jazz. And yet, when that's your first introduction to it, at a very young age, as a jazz guy, I'm like, okay, jazz has all this inside of it. This sounds like classical in some ways. And it takes a while for the separation of the wheat from the chaff so you can hear clearly what's driven by blues and emoting and improvisation and what's driven by composition and arrangement and what's on the page. And very few, I'm looking at you, Duke Ellington, very few can do both really well. Gil Mel, like I said, moves into the TV composer film thing almost completely by the mid 60s into the 70s. I'm gonna put Gildenau back on here. We'll stop playing the blues. Uh-oh. The sub's sinking. The hull's about to give way. The pretty lady back in Genoa isn't gonna see her lovely husband again. But them sharks gonna get a good meal. Like, it's, the lines are definitely, he's lurched well across. He's given credit for over 100 films and dozens of television shows. He composed the first television, American television theme that was completely using electronic instruments as Rod Sterling's Night Gallery. Another show I'm familiar with, but it was, some guy had to do that first. It's all electronic, and it was definitely the place where music was going, where today most music is only electronic, produced by computers and synthesizers. And the more elaborate your production gets today, the more you're going to be living in the digital world, because the average guy doesn't have access to an orchestra to help him chamber some arrangements up. And the players who could play those charts are fewer and far between. It's a bit like building a great old building. It'd be great to build an old cathedral like we used to, but find me 10 stonemasons. Find me 10 guys that could really chisel a rock and make a temple. Like, skilled laborers, skilled craftsmen, we're a dying breed. Well, I don't know why I said we. I ain't a skilled craftsman. They are a dying breed. My dad was a woodworker. He built pipe organs in some churches in Detroit, D.C., Virginia, one in Connecticut or Massachusetts when I was a kid, in Winnipeg, Toronto, in Quebec. We were out in Newfoundland for a while. It was an interesting thing to do when I was 1, 2, 3 years old, spend time in various churches. And a few of those churches in D.C. and in Detroit were black, gospel, Baptist, potato salad, tambourine, dancing, drum set having churches. I'd never seen church like that before. I'd never seen a black person before I went to the nursery in D.C. as a two-year-old. And I'm sitting in this black church nursery with a bunch of black kids, and I had no, I wasn't afraid of them. Being from Toronto, outside of Toronto in Guelph, I wasn't afraid of them by any means. I remember in my innocence, my mom has photo albums where I call them the chocolate faces. That's all my young mind could reference as them, and I like chocolate. Yum. Good stuff. And I had a great time, great friends with those kids. We were swimming in pools together, having a great time. Race wasn't even something that a young mind considers. But it did interest me in the black church in some ways, and it did trigger in me a lifelong interaction with the black community that has only been stronger the last 20 years. So he moves into film, and this is one of the interesting things I want to last share here, is that a guy like Gil Mel can turn his music career into a career in Hollywood. He can make a few jazz records, and he actually made some album covers too, for Monk, for Rollins, for Miles. So he was a graphic designer as well early on. He plays with a lot of the greats. He actually had his sculpture and his art being shown in New York City in various galleries and museums back in the 50s. So he was a multifaceted guy from the get-go. So the chances of him staying in jazz and just learning the blues and emoting were pretty minimal. But that's one of the reasons why black and white musicians are different, is their trajectories are going to be far different. If you're Eddie Griffin and Lockjaw Davis, the blues that you kill in 1957, and they kill it, are going to be the same blues you're killing in 1965. And they still kill it. And then 1972 comes along, and if we alive, we still going to kill the blues. And 1986 comes around, guess what we're going to be doing? We still going to be killing the blues. Because that's what jazz is. It's so rooted in the blues and that freedom of expression. The notion of jazz needing to become free one of the most ironic statements ever. Nothing freer than me being able to moat on a map I'm comfortable with. I know these chord changes. There's nothing constricting about them. I take a left turn here, I go straight 400 yards, a right turn, then we come back this way. I can do it in my sleep. So I can be free to go wherever my mind wants to wander, where my emotions want to take me. If I gotta stop and constantly be looking at the bass player and the drummer going, where's that change? Where are we gonna go this way? And I don't know my way around? What's free about that? That's confusion. People get lost. Piano players fall off. Drummers lose the beat. It's puzzling to me how people champion free jazz like it was freeing jazz from anything. Last thing I want to talk about, and I did a great episode on Donald Byrd. It's been watched by a lot of people. I just recently got this in the mail, Donald Byrd chant. Pepper Adams, Herbie Hancock, Doug Watkins, Terry Robinson. I wanted to bring it up because I didn't have it when I made my episode. And I found a copy for $20 with $4 shipping. I just got it in the mail yesterday. And I gotta say, I'm pretty pleased with the Tone Poet Records. The photographs are nice. They're more affordable than the Music Matters. They're not the annoying 45 RPM. And what I think they're doing as good as anything is the Tone Poet Records are putting great covers that are Blue Note worthy on a lot of great unreleased or much later released Blue Note stuff. And so while I'm not going to go out and get all the Tone Poets of records I already own and have, the Grant Green records that were never issued or issued with bad covers, the Hank Mobley Poppin' with that awful cover, Donald Byrd Chant, I got the great Tina Brooks record. These are records that weren't issued at the time. They're doing very noble justice to the art, the packaging, and they're pricing them fairly reasonably. And so, hats off to Tone Poet for that. And if anybody has a copy of Grant Green Matador, they want to move along to me, Tone Poet, I'd be happy to help you out with that. There's a few other ones, too, that I need to track down, but yeah, my money's pretty tight right now. So anyway, I appreciate you all. Give me your thoughts and opinions on jazz and classical and how you feel they interface. And dig Gil Mel, buy his stuff, especially if it's affordable, but understand how different a white guy's interaction with jazz is. And he might play some swinging stuff. Jerry Mulligan swings hard. But he might also decide to go make music for films. Jazz was dying, you know? And if you go make music for films and stop playing jazz, you're obviously on some level following the money and the opportunity. And on some level, it may not be in your blood quite the same way as a guy like Lockjaw Davis. And a lot of jazz men die with their reeds in their mouths. These guys play until they're literally physically not able to do so any longer. You know, the amount of guys I've heard of and read about who were rushed to hospital off of stage or on their way to a show. It's just so entrenched in how they live and breathe that I think they feel lost without it. And Gil Mel walked away in 1962. Probably never looked back. He's an important part of the Blue Note story. Makes a couple great records on Prestige. Definitely worth checking him out. But I think it's interesting to hear how different the trajectories can be and how even blindfolded sometimes you can hear the difference between a white cat and a brother playing some blues Not saying some white cats can't kill the blues, because they can. But anyway, I'm Dan, the Jazz Shepherd. Y'all be safe. I appreciate y'all telling me where you're from in your comments. I'm a geography guy. I like to know that. From Singapore to Australia, from Scotland to Germany, from Austria to Denmark, Canada, U.S. We have a couple South Americans in the fold. It's great hearing that global love for jazz still be alive in so many places. Y'all be safe. Have a great day. Peace.